1, versículo 1. Primero libro en la Biblia. Where is Patty or Mike Wallace when you need them, huh? Oh, he is? All right, in Genesis, chapter 1, verse 1, says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. All right, we've been discussing comparisons and differences in relationship to the view of matter or creation based on God or based on science. And we have been discovering that science can only see so far. And that's because creation is not divine. You can examine God's creation all you want, and that creation in itself, because it's not divine, will never produce God. You know, that's like, that would be like man building an automobile, and then we die off the planet and some alien comes and finds the automobile and says, this is their creation, this is what they're like, we're going to find them in this. No, you won't. Creation is exactly that. Something that did not exist, God created it. It's not divine. But the divine one did create it. And to study science apart from hearing from God is a little bit like, you know, looking at a map. A map is good. A map is helpful. But a map doesn't tell you everything about the countryside. You know, I mean, there are barns and there are people and there are beautiful things that a map never shows you. And this goes along with that thing that I was trying to bring out initially when we started this class, what I call that sense of awe. That that a map doesn't inspire awe, but the countryside does. And so even though science can draw us a map, even though it can give us a picture of certain things, how things went or how things are going to go or whatever, it leaves out, science makes things very sterile, very understandable, but without any sense of awe. And so, you know, if we were to, as Christians, if we were to begin to understand as scientists, we would miss a whole lot. For example, to a scientist, music, all music would be to a scientist would be vibrations in the air. Vibrations in the air. That's a scientific explanation right there of music. Okay, well, some of us around here think that there's more to music than just vibrations in the air. Or, for example, a painting. A painting would be nothing more than pigmented chemicals. And they'd look at it and they'd want to chip some of it off. You know, if they had a Van Gogh or a Michelangelo, they'd want to chip it off and examine the paint of what chemicals it's made out of. And, you know, it's a painting is more than a collection of chemicals. And music is more than just vibrations in the air. And finding God's heart is more than understanding anything that he ever made. That nothing that he made will ever truly, truly express his heart. And that's why God sent Jesus. Because the Bible says he is the express image of God. That Jesus is the explanation of God. And a scientist would take the best thing that he could find to discover Jesus, the Shroud of Turin, and he would carbon date it to find out if it goes back to the, you know, to that time period. And if it didn't, he might even discredit Jesus Christ. But there's no guarantee the Shroud of Turin has ever had anything to do with Jesus. We say, well, it's a guy that died and he's got a beard. Well, you know, I think all Jews had beards. And many Romans did too. And so we can approach God from a scientific point of view. We can understand many, many things, but are we finding his heart? Are we finding the true meaning of who he is? Not just what he can make, what powers he has, but who he is. And if we are, then we're past science. We're past religion. Now we're moving on a realm of the Spirit that will lead us to the inner being, not just the inner workings, but the inner being of God himself. It's a little bit like the difference between the brain and the mind. Okay? Well, the brain is a physical organ, right? The brain is a physical organ, but the mind is not a physical organ. There's a big difference between the brain and the mind. And, you know, some people are so impressed with, you know, technology today and AI, artificial intelligence, and how these things are developing and whatever. But a computer, I don't care how sophisticated, has no awareness. It has no awareness. And yet through the mind we have awareness, yes. The brain is the organ through which the mind works. It's a little bit like trying to find meaning in something, in some words, and the words help you to understand the meaning, but the words are just ink on white paper. They're not the meaning. Your mind or your spirit is going to have to capture the meaning. And if it doesn't, then it's just ink on white paper. It makes absolutely no difference. And only if we thought a computer had awareness would we feel that it's ethically wrong to unplug a computer. You know, I mean, every time we'd shut off our computer and unplugged it, we'd go, oh my God, I can't do this to my computer. It's aware. No, we don't feel bad at all. We immediately, you know, I mean, there are times, I know you shouldn't do it, but there are times that I've just jerked the plug out of the wall with my computer because it wasn't shutting down right or something was going wrong. I'm like, hey, dude. You know, pew, you know, I didn't go, oh my God, I've shut down consciousness. I didn't go through any ethical battle or freak out or whatever. I just unplugged the darn thing, you know. And that's showing us that there is a difference. There's a difference between computers and us. There's a difference between our computer, the brain, and us. And science will take that thing which is material, matter. And he will, even though he'll work it down to the smallest thing, such as quantum physics, such as string theory in physics, he's still seeking to understand matter, the basis of matter, or matter is material, the material world. He's trying to lay hold of the meaning of life and the meaning of all things by simply digging deeper and deeper into matter. And yet, Jesus said, God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And there is no hope of understanding someone that truly, I'm not talking about anybody that talks about God. I mean somebody that truly is speaking spirit and life. There is no hope to understand them by taking their explanations to a Bible dictionary and trying to, like you would Webster's dictionary, and trying to find the meaning through that means. The only way is that you yourself will have to go to the very heart of God and have the Holy Spirit open his heart, open his being, open the things as he sees them, the things as they are in the mind, not in the brain. The Bible said, let this mind be in you, talking about the mind of Christ. It didn't say, let this brain be in you. I remember thinking about that and going, you know, it didn't say, let this brain be in you. It's not talking about some sort of electrical magnetic workings of God as opposed to our workings. It is genuinely related to attitudes and how we proceed. Don't fight it, let it. He won't force it, let it, let. The word let is a submissive word. It's not a power word. You know, I command you to, let this mind be in you. He'll never force that mind to be in you. If you resist it, then you resist it. He gave you free will. He gave you the ability to receive or to reject. He gave you the ability to choose. And you yourself was the only one who can choose the heart of God over, can I put it this way, the science of God. Don't confuse what I meant there when I said the science of God with Christian Science, which is not really Christian Science at all. It's Christian science fiction, but that's another story. But it is. If anybody knows anything about it, Christian Science is really based on Christian science fiction. He was a science fiction writer, the guy who created the whole deal. And so, anyway, we've been building toward this thing of trying to find the awe in the things of God, trying to not have a scientific approach, but trying to see past the matter and past the things. And let's see. I think I'm going to pick up where I left off last class now. I just wanted to give an introduction. So I'll just read this statement. Your approach to truth makes a difference, and so does your center. What is the center? What is the thing that holds the parts together? What is the focal point? What is the thing by which all of these things find unity. It's the center point. And your approach to truth will be based on how you approach the center. What do you consider the center? What do you consider the focal point? What do you consider the shall I say, the target? What do you hold as that thing which is central to everything else? Central to everything else. Now, what we've discussed in the prior classes is there are many pieces to the pie. You can have any number of pieces, and all of them seem important. All of them, you know, having their place. But if you make that the central thing, if you make that thing, if you make prayer the central thing, if you make evangelism the central thing, if you make the home or the family the central thing, if you make any of those things, if you make it the central thing, then you do not have that which holds it all together. You do not have that which makes it all. And that's the key word there, because the center is not all. It is the center, but it fills all. So that prayer is no longer a subject in itself. It is a son or daughter, but son by Christ, talking to the Father. It's not a religious ritual that you do. It is a life ritual. It's like, you know, it's like my daughters, if they need to talk to me, then they find the time and they come to me and we talk, or they call me or whatever. You find yourself talking to the Father by the Son that is within you. You know, He's the one who is literally reaching out to the Father. And let's just be honest. If prayer is up to you, if prayer is up to you, there ain't gonna be a lot of praying going on. For most people, there won't be a lot of praying going on. But if it's up to Him, you'll find yourself talking to God without going through any religious motions and not even remember that you were praying, because you weren't praying. You were talking to God, which is prayer, so you were praying. And if that confuses you, Alejandra, it confused them too. And so, you know, this reality of your central, what is central to you makes all the difference in the world. For example, when, you know, they were studying the night sky. This is, you know, from the beginning of time till now, when people would study the night sky, well, they would notice certain things. They would notice, and if you watch it enough, and you would, and they thought that the earth was the center, not the sun. And in English, sol equals sun. Well, you know. And iha equals sun. Sun, so sun, sun. Cristo. There's your quick explanation. And they thought not the sun was the center, but the earth was the center. But as you watched in the night sky and you watched regularly, you would notice some weird phenomena. you would notice that some planets, after a while, some planets look like they would literally stop, and some would look like they'd be moving forward like all the other planets do, and then literally look like they start reversing. And they were confused because this didn't fit with their understanding, because if the Earth was the center, then everything ought to just make a regular rotation around. Amen? If the Earth is the center, then everything should have a normal pattern. But this pattern was throwing them, because they're going, now what is it, you know, why is this happening like this? And it wasn't until a long time later that a guy named Copernicus came up with a whole new theory. He said, you know what? The Earth is not the center. The sun is the center. The sun is the center of our universe, of our solar system. And so they all started going, you know, of course there was a backlash. Well, that can't be true. It's always been this way. And you know how that goes. Yeah. People always react. But then many of them began, you know, many of them had to look at the situation and say, you know what, if the Earth is the center, then something else is off, because this thing is not working properly. Things are not flowing properly. So when they started calculating that the sun was the center, then it began to make sense. Then they began to see patterns that they couldn't have seen before. They couldn't have seen it because of why? Wrong center. Their approach to truth was wrong. Their center for the truth was wrong. And it makes a difference what your center is. It makes a huge difference. It makes a huge difference, because if you want things to work in your life, if you want things to work in your ministry, you have to have the right center. Because then there's a flow that's set up, that God set up so that this would flow correctly. And you're going to be confused. As long as you're choosing something else in this pie, as long as you're choosing that as the center, there's always going to be other areas that don't line up. Do you understand? Maybe you'll get one or two lined up, but everything won't line up until Christ is the center. And so, and again, you know, shall I say it? There are many Christians, I'd say a huge number, say that they are Christ-centered. Anybody know someone who says they're Christ-centered and yet they have no concept of their life totally flowing around Jesus Christ, much less Him being their life? Because you're not truly Christ-centered until Christ is your life, and then you're no longer Christ-centered, you're Father-centered. Isn't that funny? Funny how that works. And if you would like, speaking of prayer and speaking of Christ-centered, go through the New Testament. I did this. Go through the New Testament and check every time you see a prayer. Just look at it and see who's being prayed to. Almost every time it's a prayer to the Father. Now, why is that? Because the Son, Christ in us, is our life, and no matter who's praying the prayer, it's always going to the Father. Does that make sense? It's Christ in you that's performing all the periphery, all the things of the circumference, and the things of the circumstance, the things outside the realm of the center. He is what holds it all together. He is. Jesus is what makes it mesh. And without that, we're just scientists, Christian scientists again or whatever, but we're just scientists. Because man's center was off, his calculations and conclusions did not all make sense, talking about before Copernicus. Many things added up, but other parts seemed to bring confusion. But when the sun became the center, all began to make sense and became orderly. All right. From this we see that there are greater movements, and this is important. We should all conclude there are greater things outside of our knowledge. I remember when I was 21, 22 years old, sitting in Bible school. And I remember some of my teachers saying things that I'd never heard before. Can you imagine? I mean, saying things I'd never heard before, and they didn't jive, they didn't match up to what I already knew. And I thought, well, that can't be right. This is what I thought. Well, that can't be right, because I know everything, and so they couldn't possibly be speaking anything that is outside the realm of my 21-year-old. Honestly, at that time, about 6 months experience in the Lord. Not even a year. Well, but if somebody said something that was outside the realm of my understanding, my first thought was it was heresy. Anybody ever listen to someone else and they say something, you're like, what? That ain't right. Man, I cannot tell you when I was in Bible school how many times I said, that ain't right. I can't tell you how many times I stood up in church service and rebuked the leaders or the person speaking in the name of what was right. I did. And then, I'd leave the church and I'd go to my room and the Holy Spirit would spank me severely, and I would weep and cry and come back to the next service and go, you remember that stuff I said? Sorry, Well, I did that so often that I finally realized, if you want to get out of the embarrassment of standing up and apologizing all the time and feeling like an idiot and everybody thinking you're an idiot, if you'd like to get over that hump, shut your mouth. Don't talk so much. Just be slow to speak and swift to hear. And I thought, it's a scripture, ain't it? Maybe that's right. Maybe there's some validity to that. Well, it took me longer than it took most of you. But I wanted to know the truth. I really did. And I wanted to stand up for the truth. And then I realized I'm not standing up for the truth. I don't know the truth. I am much too young at this stage to be trying to teach anybody until I've got some things down settled in me. And so there is a necessity to learn that there are greater realities beyond what we know. There are greater realities beyond what I know. Greater realities, greater movements, speaking of the planets, greater spheres going on than what we're aware of. And a lot of times we get so focused on our existence and our world that we become unteachable. We can't look beyond that. For example, better take this with me here. For example, the Earth. Okay, well, the Earth, here it is. The Earth spins on its axis, right? The Earth spins around on its own axis. And so it's just going, around and around and around. And it is all wrapped up in its own flight, its own center. And the center being the center of itself and it's spinning around at 700 miles per hour. Okay. Now that's a lot. That's fast. That's faster than a Mustang. That's faster than a lot of cars. All right. And so as an earthling, as one who is of the earth, we're aware of what's going on around us. We're aware of what, you know, how we're going around and what's going around with us and all the stuff that's going on there. And we're impressed with our, you know, we're impressed with our speed and what have you. But, you know, the earth is rotating around the sun, right? And it's doing a rotation around the sun. But if you're unaware of that, you're only aware of the own, your own spin, then you're only aware of yourself as the center of the earth being the axis, and you're only aware of what you're caught up in and what have you. And you don't realize that this thing is, let's see, I've got it written down here. Yeah, this is 70,000 miles per hour. This path set before man was on the earth, set by God, that it wasn't just meant to spin on his axis at 700 miles an hour. He was meant to travel around the sun. He was meant for the sun to be central to his whole existence, and to find that, and to realize that that's your, you know, earth, that's your primary course, set by God, settled. It's your lifelong direction, right? But that's not the end of it. Because we're the center, we think that's the end of it. But when the sun becomes the center, then we realize that the sun has a path in the cosmos, that it is going around bigger than this board, bigger than what we can draw here. And the sun, we're attached to the sun, but the sun is moving at 500,000, or actually I think it's, yeah, 500,000 miles per hour. That is so much beyond the speed of the axis of the earth. That is even so much more than the speed of our being centered on Christ. That is us not finding this big, large path for us, but us staying in tune with the Lord in his path as he travels throughout the heavens. See? I want to be an astronaut. I want to be a spiritual astronaut. I want to travel the heavens. The only way you're going to do that, your path, if it's you, your path is already set. You're to be centered on him. But his path, and we're joined to him in that path. Do you realize that? It's his path, though. It's not your path. It's his path. But you're joined to him in that path. And so, I mean, that's a, you know, 700 miles per hour compared to 500,000 miles per hour throughout the cosmos is just incredible. Before I forget it, Robert, I've brought your song. I'd like for you to listen to it during break time, if we could do that. Let you listen to it just to see what you think. Okay. I wasn't expecting to see you, but I thought, well, I might. So praise God. All right. So, can you see this reality that man was on the earth and he thought the earth was the center and therefore the axis is the center, but then he changed what was the center and the sun became the center and he began to do that rotation around the sun, having him always in the center, but then we realize that the sun himself has a path that goes so far and so distant that we can't even comprehend the fullness of that path. And our only hope to make that path with him is to be joined to him in what he's called to. That's like the bride of Christ. To be joined with him in his massive path, and therefore what's true of him is true of us, isn't it? Where he goes, what? We go. Whatever distance he goes, we go. Now, here's the interesting thing. Jesus is the center. I mean, let me say it like this. Jesus is the center. We don't make him the center. We find him to be the center. Come on, think about it. He's always the center. He's the center of what God, of creation. He is, everything was made for him and to him and by him and through him and by him all things consist. He's the center of everything that's important. He's the center. We don't make him that. We find, my God, he's the center of all things. Does that make sense? And so the truth is, he's always been on this path. I mean, you can be on the earth spinning around, you know, on your little axis going, you know, oh, it's all about me. I'm spinning around in my world. Oh, we're going, you know, this seems fast. Life on earth's fast. That ain't nothing to 500,000 miles per hour going with him, baby. You ain't moved. You ain't even left the house. You know, until you've been joined with him. But we don't even know it. We barely know we're spinning around, if you think about it. I mean, you know, we are spinning. 700 miles an hour is pretty good, you know, zipping around on the axis of the earth. We just think we're walking from one room to the next. It's all about me. It's all about my life. It's all about my friends, all three. One. You know, it's all about, you know. Well, no, it's not. And we don't even know the speed of the reality of going around the sun, just circulating around the sun, and that's been going on since the beginning of time. It's been going on, you know, certainly since the beginning of our solar system. That's been true. Just because Copernicus found it out didn't make it true at that instant. Are you following what I'm saying? Truth is true. That's why we call it truth. You should write that down. Truth is true. That's why we call it truth. And what I mean by that is it's always been true. You don't make it true by believing it. You find it to be true, and you go, oh, my God, he's always been the center. He's always, and I'm joining the great throng of those who believe that. We are Copernicusites. But Copernicus had no clue of how the sun itself was on a huge path. He just thought the sun sat there in the middle and went, just shine, you know, hey, I'm just shining. No, the sun has a path too. What is that, Psalm 19? The sun has a path, and the sun is headed through the heavens and through the fullness of this. He's the one who possesses the land. He's the one who does the traveling. We are joined with him in his task. We are joined with him in his heart. We give up, as it were, focus on our axis turning. And we become more than centered on, we become more than having him the center of our lives. Get it? The difference? Our lives. He's the center of our lives. That means we're still going. No. Once you realize this huge path that he's making through the cosmos, we are joined with him in his task. And in all of that, we have him in the center. See? Because our path, it's set. This is our path. If you're going to find a true path, this is ours. But if you're going to truly embrace that path of Christ being the center, of the Son being the center, then you are going to be joined with Him on a much larger path that will take you places you could never have gone. Can I get an amen, Healy's? Take you places you've never gone. Lord told me that I was studying, just reading my Bible and sitting before Him, and He said, tell Kim something for me. I said, okay. He said, I brought the Healy's here first before the other Healy's. He said, I did that. They might have thought they did that, but I did that. He said, and I wanted Kim to know, I wanted her to get here and become a part of a big family first. Yeah. That makes sense to you, doesn't it? Totally. That you were brought here to be made into this family first, so that your standing would never be changed or moved. That was settled first in His heart, just like what we're talking about here. First in His heart, and now in your heart and in your circumstances. And that everyone here knows you as the Kim of the family. The Kim of the family. You're not coming in later. And of course, that's true for all of you, but the Lord told me to specifically tell you, you know, that whatever happens later on doesn't change history. You see what I mean? Doesn't change the history of His order. And He brought you here for that purpose, so that you would be settled in with your family. You'd already have a lounge chair with it bending in with your shape, and hey, I'm part of this. And then whoever came after that, it's like, hey, welcome to the family. I was blessed by that. I know you are. I know you are. All right. Well, let me read this last sentence on this page anyway. But the earth was meant to have a greater involvement than just being centered on the sun. It was meant to be involved in the heavenlies. The sun has its own path that is different than the earth. The sun's motion makes it travel through the Milky Way galaxy at 500,000 miles per hour on its personal journey. Because of gravity, we have been pulled along with Him into a path we would never have except as we are joined to Him. It is not our path, but His. Our path is to center on Him. His has wider movements as its center. All right, we may not understand all that. I mean, you know, all the ramifications of that. A lot of times we don't understand things because we think that we're so, not us personally, but mankind, we think that we're so much the center of things that, well, if I had have made things, if I had have been God, if I'd have made things, well, I'd have done it this way. Anybody ever thought something like, well, I'd have done it this way? I mean, whether it's creation or how to run something that God's already set up in order. I only got one laugh on that one, two. You know, I'm talking to you, Hope, folks here. We're having a little talk now. Daddy's talking. That, you know, so I better get off of the practical lest you figure it out. If I could have made everything, I would have made gravity stronger. Okay? Well, you don't even know what that means. If you'd made gravity stronger, that meant you'd make everybody shorter. That's the natural outcome of making gravity stronger, is that it just pulls you down. Everybody'd be walking, hey. You know? And if God allowed you to do that, after a while you go, this is dumb. Can we go back to the original way? Can we go back the way it was supposed to be? We don't even know. We think we got it figured out, but there are angles and ramifications that come into this stuff that we don't know. Your best bet is to say, not my will, but thine be done. Yes, Lord. How about that one? Yes, Lord. See, big above guy, Lord. El Señor. Si, Señor. I am with you in your course. I'm not trying to figure it all out. I just, number one, I want to be with you, and number two, I don't want to make dumb mistakes by making gravity too strong or making this or that. I mean, you know, whatever thing that you could come up with in that situation. All right. Let me move on here. I want to talk about quantum physics. Now, this is astrophysics. This is the universe. This is the cosmos. All of this has to do with planets and suns and all of it from that angle. Quantum physics has to do with subatomic particles, so small that you can't see them, and you can't even see them with the most high-powered microscope. Quarks and gluons, and you know, you can't see them. You don't, you know, I mean, string theory is so far beyond that, but what it is is a beginning of trying to comprehend, science-wise, to comprehend where everything came from. Spiritually, it is breaking everything down past, if there are 12 foundations, it is breaking it down to the foundation that is the final building block of all things. Okay, so that's what we're talking about in the Lord. It is important to see the big picture. Can I get amen? It's important to see the big picture. Not everybody, by the way, has the ability to see the big picture. But it's important to see the big picture. If we do not do so, then we are doomed to only reaching so far. Meaning, we will stay within the confines. We will not see how our part fits with anything else. And therefore, we will take the attitude that my part is more important than everyone else's. And then we will take the attitude, then why don't I get the honor I deserve? And then we will take the attitude, you see how this keeps building and building, why don't we all just crucify Randy? And then you see where all this ends up? So I'm trying to help change you until it's too late for me. All right. So, however, much like a puzzle, the big picture is only comprehended as all the smaller pieces are put together. We went to the science fair, and Ezzy and Alejandro were putting together a puzzle there. And I noticed they started with the corners, and they started working, and each piece had its place, and they didn't even know what the picture was, right? You did or didn't? I mean, I didn't know. I mean, it's, how do I know what this is? You can see part of it. You know, if I left before I got to see the picture, but I mean, if it was a person's face, you see a nose there, and you go, what's that all about? And then you look over here, and there's an onion. You're going, well, this ain't about vegetables, is it? Or, well, you know, well, you have to put it all together, you know. You have to put it all together. I remember one time, I forget where we were, and they had this puzzle. We were in different teams, and they said, okay, so this, it wasn't a huge puzzle, but it was pretty big, and they said, okay, I want you to look at the picture, look at it real good. They gave everybody their puzzle. Look at it real good. And then, you know, and after a few minutes, I'm going to have you break up the puzzle and re-put it back together, and whoever puts it back the fastest wins. So they left, the moderator left, and I started sticking a piece of cardboard under there, flipped it over, and they said, how are we going to study the picture and figure out what this picture is with you flipping it over? And I got my pen out, started numbering it while it was still together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Flipped it back over, moderator came, said, okay, tear it up. So flipped it back over, started putting the pieces, and finished like that, and flipped it back over, said, we're done. They went, how did you do that? Everything fits. And there are actually ways in the Lord of doing things that are way faster than our minds trying to figure out, okay, I got these, you know, all these pieces. Does this go? How does this go? You know, God sees beyond what we see, and there are methods beyond what we know. So anyway, the big picture is the sum of its parts. Not really and not completely, but we'll get it. We're talking about the big picture. We'll stick with that. The big picture is the sum of its parts. To have a big picture view without still being aware of all the little things that make it up would be like a man who works his whole life to provide for his family, but forgets to use some of that money to get her a birthday gift. Big things are comprised of small things added up. All right, now why did I say that? I said that because if we work to pay the bills, we've lost the all. And that's the only way I know how to put it. I mean, I'm just trying to be real here. We've lost the, anything that's beautiful in life, we've lost that, and we're just going through the motions. And I know, you know, the generation before mine, the people in the 50s and whatever, my God, that was it. You just work and you come home and you didn't relate to your kids and you didn't hardly relate to your wife, but you looked like you did because everything looked like the Leave It to Beaver family. But it wasn't like that. In reality, there was a lot of ugliness and a lot of alcoholism in that generation, and just a lot of insensitivity. to have the big picture, well, it's a man should provide for his home, and we're just using this as an example. He should. That's okay. I don't have a problem with that. But when it becomes so structured that that's the big picture is all there is to it, and we don't see how the little pieces are, you know, or if we lose any of the little pieces, the whole picture is going to fall apart. Okay, that's what I'm talking about. Physics explains the physical world. Physical. Okay. Matter. Physics, physical. Quantum physics seeks to discover what matter really is. Or what matters. No, what matter really is. Sorry, I didn't say that there. My mind went off for a second. What are the building blocks of the material world? That's what physics is trying to figure out. What are the building blocks of the material world? Science doesn't know. They don't know. They haven't known forever. They've never known. At least they've got some gumption and they're trying to know. Yes, their center is wrong, so you can't, you know. It's you know, the example I always use is that if I had a silver dollar and I dropped it and it rolled over into that corner over there and I spend all my time looking up here, I'll never find it. I'm looking in the wrong place. You have to look where God wants you to look. All right. Quantum theory is man's theoretical framework designed to explain the outer world. All right. I'm going to stop right there because we barely... We've barely come into quantum physics, and this course is almost over. But I'm going to go ahead and stop, and we'll take a break and come back in a little bit. So go ahead.